Hey guys, it's Bella and welcome back to my channel. I hope you're all having an incredible day today. In today's video, we are going to be covering another case for my 12 Days of Christmas. I really hope you guys are enjoying the 12 Days of Christmas again. And if you are, please make sure to give this video a big thumbs up for me so that I know that you want me to keep doing them. And let's go ahead and get into today's case. Before we get into this case, I do just want to mention that it is pretty graphic, it's pretty horrific, so if that's not something you feel comfortable listening to, then this might not be the video for you. I always give Kerry the down low on my videos because I find these cases just as fascinating as you guys. It's the reason I started this whole series, is because I want to share them, I want to talk about them, I find them really interesting. And when I was telling Kerry about this one, he actually didn't want to hear like all of the graphic details because, like I said, it is a pretty horrific case. So today we're going to be covering the Hello Kitty murders, and this was a huge case in Hong Kong. It's like one of their most famous cases, and I think the reason that it's such a famous case is because not only is it so horrendous, like the judge on the case, Peter Nguyen, actually said that it was one of the most depraved, horrendous acts of cruelty he's ever seen in all of his years as a judge. But it's also like the juxtaposition of this horrible, brutal crime and then this cute little icon that is Hello Kitty. But also at the time, I don't know if it's the same now, but back when this happened in 1999, Hong Kong's homicide rate was like 1.23 in 100,000, which is actually one of the lowest of any major city. In May of 1999, a 14-year-old girl made her way to the police station in Tsim Sha Tsui, which is in Hong Kong, and she was very clearly in distress, and she started telling them about these nightmares that she had been having and that she was like being haunted by like ghosts. Initially, they didn't really believe her because, you know, she's this 14-year-old girl, she's being haunted by ghosts, like it's not really something the police deal with. They kind of deal with, you know, real life crime rather than nightmares and somebody who thinks they're being haunted. But they heard her out because she was alone and she was very clearly like going through it, like she was not having a good time. As she's talking, as police are hearing her out, she mentions that the woman that's haunting her is a woman that was tortured and murdered in the apartment she'd been staying at Grand Road. Again, police didn't really look too much into what she was saying because it's a ghost story, it's a haunting, like who knows, she could have just made this up in her head and in her dreams. But then she mentions that she actually participated in the torture and murder of this woman. And that's when police were like, oh shit, maybe this is a real thing. This is a real woman who was tortured and murdered, if this girl was actually involved in the whole thing. So maybe it's something we should look into. So they get the girl to take them to the apartment, which is in the Kowloon district. And this wasn't really like the nicest district. I'm not sure what it's like now, but in 1999, it was not the nicest district. It was pretty run down and the buildings all were built like really haphazardly and it looked like they could just like collapse on each other at any time. When they arrived at the apartment that the girl had brought them to, the police realized that all of these nightmares she'd been telling them about were actually very real. And it was also really bizarre because the apartment was like covered in Hello Kitty merch, like Hello Kitty bed sheets, Hello Kitty curtains, pillows, Hello Kitty stuffed toys, like, but then the apartment itself was just so like gross and dingy and disgusting. Obviously, they had no idea how this like 14-year-old girl got involved in something as disgusting as this, but then they soon realized that she had a 34-year-old boyfriend. I don't know if it was like her actual boyfriend or if it was a prostitution type of deal, but he was always referred to as her boyfriend and he was like this really scary dude. This girl, this 14-year-old girl, she hated her estate home, she hated her older brothers, she was fighting with her parents constantly. So just before the Lunar New Year in 1998, she ran away from home and had been living on the streets and gotten involved with this really scary dude that was her boyfriend. Like I said, she got into a really bad drug addiction and she got into some prostitution. And because of that, she fell in with this group of triad members. And the triad, if you don't know what that is basically like the Chinese mafia. It's like an organized crime syndicate and it is just some really bad, scary stuff. Her boyfriend was part of the triad, which is how she met him. And then he, his two henchmen, and this 14-year-old girl tortured and murdered this this woman. And mind you, at the time that this woman was being tortured and murdered, this girl was only 13 years old. So her birthday like must have happened really close to her going and talking to the police, which I just find so sad. So let's talk about what happened. The victim was 23-year-old Fan Man Yi, and she didn't have an easy life growing up, that's for sure. Her family abandoned her when she was just a kid, and she ended up at the Ma Tu Wai girls' home at the time. And I don't know if it was just the orphanage that she was staying at or if it was all orphanages in Hong Kong, but basically once you turned 16, they said, see you later, you're old enough to fend for yourself, which I don't really understand, because at 16 years old, if you get kicked out of home, like, and you're at an orphanage, where are you going to go? How is a 16-year-old just gonna go out into the world, get a job magically like that, and earn enough money to be able to pay bills and rent and food and all of that kind of thing? But anyway, once she turned 16, they said, see you later. They kicked her out of their orphanage and she went to the streets. She became addicted to drugs, and to pay for her addiction, she started getting into prostitution. She would work at nightclubs, she would work at brothels, and she would also work on the street. In May of 1996, she was working at Empress Karaoke Nightclub, and it was there that she almost found happiness. She was trying to turn her life around when she met her husband. They got married, obviously. They moved in together and they had a son together, but unfortunately, they had a very rocky relationship. Her husband was addicted to drugs, and her neighbors would complain constantly about hearing loud domestic abuse coming from their apartment. So turns out her husband had been abusing her the entire time, and their relationship ultimately ended because of it. Soon after, in 1997, Fan Yi started working at Romance Villa, which was like a club slash brothel in the Kowloon district, and a lot of tribe members really liked to come to this brothel, and so it was here that she met a man named Chan Man Lop. He ended up becoming a regular client of hers. I think she was like his favorite prostitute or something, and he would pay her for like really, really long sex sessions, and they would like binge on ice together as well during these sex sessions. And she knew exactly what type of guy he was. She knew that he was part of the triad. She knew that he was like high up. He was this really scary dude with a lot of money, but also a lot of connections. But in early March of 1999, despite all of this, she decided to take a chance and steal Man Lok's wallet, which is not your best decision, like stealing from a member of the mafia. But they were high on ice at the time, and he had about 4,000 Hong Kong dollars in there, which is about 700 Australian dollars. And mind you, when she did this, it was just the two of them in the room having sex, doing ice. So like, it was pretty obvious who took the wallet. And so he went up to her, he's like, pay me back my $4,000, but also you've disrespected me, so you need to pay me an extra $10,000 on top of that. He threatened her, he told her that he would hurt her if he didn't get his money, and pretty quickly she got him the $4,000 back. But she was like, look, I'm just gonna need a little bit more time to get you the $10,000. I don't have it on me. Obviously this is not what some big scary mafia dude wants to hear. Like, chances of her running away, pretty high probably. So he decided that his best bet, so she didn't run away, so he didn't miss out on getting this $10,000 interest, would be to kidnap her. So on the 17th of March in 1999, 34-year-old Chan Man Lok got two other members of the triad. I think they were like his henchmen or something. And they were 27-year-old Lung Shing Cho and 21-year-old Lung Wai Lun. And he got them to kidnap Fan Man Yi from her home. And they took her back to an apartment that Man Lok owned, which is the apartment on Granville Road with all of the Hello Kitty merch that I mentioned earlier. Basically, Man Lok's plan was to prostitute her out until she had paid off her debt. So he was gonna get acquaintances, people from the triad, friends, paying people to come and have sex with her until she had made $10,000 from doing this. On top of this, they ended up using her as their own personal punching bag. On the very first night that she was brought to the apartment, these men were high on ice and they decided that they were going to rape and beat her all night and until the very early hours of the next morning. And then for the next month, they tortured her. They loved to use anything and everything from the kitchen. Like, they would find creative ways to use any appliances, like everything from the kitchen. They would just find ways to use it to aid in her torture. They would use plastic straws and they would just melt the plastic straws until the hot plastic would drip onto her body and burn her while they held her down. Specifically, they would melt the straws onto the soles of her feet until they were burnt and blistered so that she couldn't just get up and leave at any time. They would hit her burnt, blistered feet with sticks. They would use water pipes and metal bars to beat her. They would make her laugh and smile and pretend to be happy through all of these beatings, and they would make her tell them how happy and how excited she was for her beatings. It was like some sort of sick game. Like, he actually got off on her pretending that she was happy to be beaten. And if she didn't do that, if she didn't pretend to be happy, if she didn't laugh, if she didn't tell him how excited she was, then he would just beat her even harder. Eventually, because she was so exhausted and because she had been so brutally beaten, none of Manlock's associates, members of the triad, or friends wanted to pay to have sex with her anymore because they just didn't find it attractive, because she was like bleeding, she had all different scars all over her body, and they just thought it was gross, and she was so exhausted that she just wasn't able to perform either. So they were like, you know, why would we pay for that when we can just go to a brothel, or we can go pay for someone on the street or something? So as soon as Manlock realized that he couldn't make any money off her, that she wouldn't be able to pay off her interest of her debt, the brutal beatings got even worse, if you can even imagine. Like, they were already so brutal and horrible, but somehow this sick, twisted monster managed to make them even worse. They would throw oyster sauce and chili oil over her face and in her eyes. And then, like, in her open wounds, they would put chili oil inside them, which literally makes me cringe thinking about just how painful that would be. They would pee into her open wounds. They would rub feces into her open wounds. They peed into her mouth and made her drink it. And they would make her eat feces. They would make her eat chili oil. They would make her eat motor oil. And at the same time, they would starve her of normal foods. If she refused to eat any of the urine or the feces, like, I'm pretty sure they made her eat her own feces as well as theirs, and if she refused to, if she gagged, if she vomited, then they would just beat her. Now, like I said, she was really weak. Like, she had been through so much. She, even if she didn't have the bottoms of her feet burnt, she would not be able to get up and walk away. She had been starved, she was exhausted, and the poor men weren't having fun anymore because she was so exhausted, and like, she wasn't even, they weren't getting like reactions out of her anymore because she was too exhausted to give a reaction. So they weren't having fun anymore. Halfway through her month of torture, they used electrical wire to tie her up to hooks on the ceiling to make her easier to beat. Like, it's actually so horrific thinking about what this poor woman had to go through for an entire month. They would beat her with iron bars and they would just leave her there to hang overnight. And while she was hanging there, they would just be in another room, like the room next door in the apartment, just playing video games and doing meth. Like, these men were actual monsters. It is just actually pure evil. At one point, Manlock's girlfriend, who was just 13 years old at the time, walked in on him kicking Manny in the head over 50 times, and she joined in too. And she joined in on like a lot of this torture. Like, I'm pretty sure Manny was also forced to eat the 13-year-old's feces as well. On the 15th of April, so almost a month after they abducted Manny, Chanlock and his girlfriend and the other two men all went out for the night. They went to arcades, they were drinking, doing ice, and they locked Manny in the bathroom while they were gone. When they came back a couple of hours later, it was pretty late, so they didn't check on her. They just went straight to bed. And then the next morning, Manlock's 13-year-old girlfriend gets up to go to the bathroom and finds Manny dead in the bathtub. That same day, there was actually police in the apartment building because they were investigating a rape downstairs. Like I said, it wasn't a great area, the place this apartment was in. And there's police in the building. They have a murdered and tortured woman in their bathroom. So they start freaking out and they're like, how do we get rid of her? What do we do? They spend the rest of that day going off all separately, coming up with different plans, brainstorming how they're going to dispose of her. And then the next morning they come back together. Manlock's like, I literally don't care what you came up with because we're using my idea. And this whole time that they're like brainstorming what to do, by the way, so the rest of the day, they just let this woman sit in the bathtub. Like, it's so sad. Anyway, Manlock decided that it was too obvious to have the body all in one piece. Like, it was too obvious for them to transport it or get rid of it in any way. So he decided that they had to dismember her, because if she was in tiny little pieces, it would be a lot easier to get rid of her. It wouldn't look like a body. It wouldn't be as suspicious. And it would just be easier for them to transport. So they started this operation to dismember her. Like, Chanlock gets a butcher's knife and just starts dismembering her head. And the other two guys are like picking all of the flesh off of her so that they could then boil all of the muscle off her bones. And they were like taking her organs out and putting them into plastic bags. Like, it's really just disgusting, gruesome stuff. And all of this whole operation of doing this took them about 10 hours. They would bag her flesh and they would put it in the fridge, and they would bag her organs as well and they would put that in the fridge. They got the 13-year-old girlfriend involved in all of this as well. Like, they got her like taking the bags and putting them in the fridge and boiling things to like stop them from smelling. Lung Xing Cho was actually boiling Man Yi's head, and he gets the 13-year-old out to come and see it, and he's like, look in the pot. And she's like, I don't want to, that's really scary. And he's like, just pretend it's on the movies. And she said that when she looked in, because he was forcing her to, that it actually did just look like something from TV. Now, because this whole operation took 10 hours, like I said, the men got hungry, so they decided to make themselves some noodles. They actually cooked it on the same stovetop that they were boiling Man Yi's head on, and they used the same spoon that they were using to stir her head to stir their noodles. It's so disgusting to think about. Eventually, once the head was boiled down to just a skull, they went and got one of their Hello Kitty plush toys. They undid it, unripped the seams, stuffed the skull inside there, and then sewed it back up. So then when Manlock's 13-year-old girlfriend went and reported all of this to police, and police came to the apartment, all that was left was the skull, one tooth that they had left on the floor, and then a bag of organs in the fridge. So without the body, obviously they couldn't determine how she died. They couldn't determine that she had been tortured. They couldn't actually prove any of what the 13-year-old girl was saying. And she's telling like one story about how they all participated in this woman's torture and murder for the past month. And then the three men, on the other hand, though, are telling this whole other story about how she was addicted to meth, she overdosed on meth, and they started panicking because they were running like this small brothel. She was one of their prostitutes and she died under their care, so they didn't want to get in trouble for that. So they decided to dismember her and then dispose of the body so that they wouldn't get in trouble for letting one of their workers die under their care. But the police weren't dumb. Like, they didn't buy their story, and even if they did, like, they still let someone die under their supervision and then dismembered them and tried to dispose of all the body and all of the evidence, which in itself is just super sketchy. Unfortunately though, because they actually had no evidence of the murder and torture, they couldn't actually charge the men with murder. They just had to charge them with manslaughter. They went to trial, and the 13-year-old girl was given full immunity because she testified at their trial about everything that had happened. The trial lasted for 6 weeks, and the whole time these men not only denied killing her, but they were just turning on each other. Like, they were like, no, he did it. And the other guy was like, no, he did it. And the other guy was like, no, 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 he did it. It was just like a whole mess. Man Yi's husband, or ex-husband, I'm not actually sure if they ever got a divorce or if they were just separated, but he also testified at the trial, and he was like, look, you're all lying about what happened because she was clean, she wasn't on meth, she stopped doing meth before her son was born. And obviously that just like totally ruined the defense's argument of the meth overdose. So in December of 2000, once the trial ended, the three men were all sentenced to the same sentence. They got life in prison with the possibility of parole after 20 years. So this year, 2020, they are eligible for parole, which is pretty scary. They were all visited by psychiatrists in prison, but none of them were found to have any mental illnesses. None of them had any remorse. They were all just literal psychopaths. So hopefully they never get parole. Like, hopefully if they apply for parole, the parole board will see it and be like, no, sir, you are not getting out into society. Not on my watch. After this whole ordeal went public, the media went crazy for it, but in the worst way possible. There were movies made about this case. One of them was called The Human Pork Chop, and the other was called There's a Head in My Soup. Like, it's honestly so disgusting and gross. They were posting Photoshop photos of her to make her look like a Japanese video game character. They were taking photos of her head that had been bound and had been beaten, and they were putting it on bodies of, like, sexy anime characters. They would title the articles things like "Girl Eats Shit and Drinks Piss." Like, the way the media handled this was appalling. People also believed that because this 13-year-old girl was being haunted by Manny's spirit, that meant it was really easy to contact Manny's spirit. So people started going to the apartment where she died and was tortured to try and contact her. It became almost like this meeting place for people who were interested in the case and also people who were interested in contacting the supernatural. It was super disrespectful and distasteful the way that these people were acting in this building though, so eventually in 2012 it was demolished. And then after that it stayed vacant for a couple years until they built a hotel on it in 2016, which I really don't know how I would feel staying at that hotel. I don't think I could do it. Just knowing that somebody was murdered there would just freak me out. I don't even believe in like paranormal stuff and ghosts, so I wouldn't necessarily be worried that I was gonna get haunted. I would just feel wrong staying in a place where I'd known something like that had happened. Manny's son is currently a student and he's studying in Singapore, and unfortunately he doesn't really remember a lot of his mum because he was just 2 years old when all of this happened, but the police gave him some of her necklaces and apparently he wears them every single day. And that is all of the information that I have on this case. I would love to hear your thoughts in the comments down below, and hopefully I will see you guys in my next video. Bye guys!